So, schön, dass Sie da sind. Wir versuchen ein bisschen die Zeit einzuholen, aber der Mann, der jetzt kommt, den muss man auf jeden Fall noch einmal ein bisschen von anderen Seiten auch beleuchten, dass er der CEO von Young & Rubicam ist. Das wissen Sie. Was Sie vielleicht nicht wissen, ist, dass er ein großer Philanthrop ist, der abseits der normalen Geschäftstätigkeit sehr, sehr viele Gedanken sich darüber macht, wie man wirklich das Leben von Menschen besser machen kann. Michael Bloomberg, der Bürgermeister von New York, hat ihn jetzt als Member of the Cultural Advisory Committee of the New York City Department of Cultural Affairs berufen. Auch das schafft der Mann irgendwie noch. Ich weiß nicht, wie er das macht zeitlich. Jetzt gerade kommt er von einer Reise zurück, die sehr spannend gewesen sein muss. Ein unglaublicher Markt aus Israel. Hier ist David Sable, meine Damen und Herren. Herzlich willkommen. Good to see you. You just came from Israel?
I just came from Israel. I was attending a conference not unlike this, not quite as many people. It's probably the number one market in the world for internet startups. Saw some amazing young companies yesterday. And
it's an unbelievable creative market in Israel.
Very creative, incredibly creative, applied technology. Use a lot of the military technology now being applied to marketing of all things, facial recognition, voice recognition, all kinds of things that will help ultimately in e-commerce. Tremendous analytics and great content development.
So now we're talking about connecting with today's global consumer generation world.
Generation world.
You're the man for that, I'm so sure. David Sable, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you. So, thank you. So here's the thing. I understand that when this conference first began, not that many years ago, it was three long white tables, bunch of guys in torn jeans, kind of sitting around waiting for people to come talk to them. Only 3 years ago, so it grew, but yet only 3 years ago at this very same conference, try to find somebody to talk about mobile and you literally had to bang your head against the wall. Today I was just down on the floor and I went around to talk to a number of the people in the mobile booths and they all told me the same thing, that all of a sudden they begin their pitch trying to explain mobile and all the clients say, no, don't explain it, we get it, just tell us what you do. Tell us how you make our business go. The world has changed and we are part of a generation world. So what I'm gonna talk today about is how we connect with the global generation, who they are exactly. Are they empowered by technology or defined by it? This is really critically important. How do we look at ourselves? Are we empowered or are we defined? Tell you about some brands that I think get it, and then talk to you about the learnings. So let's just start with data. There's nothing more important than data. The internet exists, digital exists because of data. Yet, here's the deal, right? It organizes for us, it helps us categorize, but the real question is, does it tell the story? Does it really teach us anything? There's way too much data out there. We're in a glut of data. We're seduced by data. Does it tell the story? So let's go back. Let's talk about microtrends. So many of you know the term microtrends was created during the very first presidential campaign of Bill Clinton. It was a way of looking at an audience and trying to ascribe to it certain values and attributes so that you could market in a more powerful way. The very famous example that many of you, I'm sure, have heard of was soccer moms. So who was a soccer mom? A soccer mom was a highly educated woman, probably had a job, but she took her children to soccer practice. And so because she took her children to soccer practice, we learned a few things. One is we could sell them minivans because they needed a big car with a door that slid. We could send them to Starbucks because we knew that they went there before. So it gave us a way of looking. We also knew, by the way, that their politics were probably more liberal. All in all, it fit very much the Clinton campaign and it worked very well for him. It didn't work well for Hillary 4 years ago. And instead, Barack Obama comes along because he understood something different than microtrends, and it's called a nanotrend. So let me tell you what nanotrends are, because nanotrends are what define the world today. So this is me. If you would look at me and say, okay, I get him. He is a CEO. He fits a particular category, much like a soccer mom, so he must drive a particular car. He must do a set of different things. You'd be completely wrong. Because if you looked at my profile online, what you'd find is that I'm an Xbox gamer, a big one. I'm a bit of a hippie. It embarrasses my daughters. But I have to tell you, I am a closet hippie, and so if you watch the choice of music, if you look at some of the other things I look at, some of the things I'm interested in, that would come across. I'm a sci-fi reader. I'm interested in it. I love it. I'm a world traveler. There are very few places I haven't been to, and I'm always looking for new ones. I'm an Indiana Jones junkie. I can't get enough of Indiana Jones. I love the movies. It tells you a little bit about my fantasy life and the problems I have. Ad executive, you got. I'm a blogger, and I've been blogging for many years, and I have a bit of a following. And I'm also a grandfather, which I'm very proud of. I have three young grandchildren, two boys and a girl. Now, those are my nanotrends. Each one of those things defines me at a different period of time. So here's the thing. When, if you would just try to take a look and say, okay, which of these is David? These are all terms that we use, you use, all the marketers here. We use these terms all the time. We throw them around in meetings like they're really important. So what am I, right? Am I an empty nester? Am I a hipster? I'm not Generation Z. I'm definitely an entrepreneur because I've done that. Where do I fit? So the answer is, I fit no place. Because there is no more traditional segmentation. And let me give you the proof. This is Google. How many people have looked at their profile on Google? Anybody? Okay, this is what happened when I went to look at mine. I get a call from Bloomberg News. The very day that Google allowed you to go in and look, and they said, David, go and look and see what your profile says, because we've been looking at our profiles, and some don't seem to match. What does yours say? This is what my said. No demographic categories are associated with you. Why is that? Because they couldn't figure out who the hell I was. Was I a hippie? Was I an ad executive? What was I? Now think about it, right? So they're saying no ad preferences could be assigned to me. So Google, if you're here, I apologize. But what the hell are you selling my name for? And to whom? You have no idea who I am. So ergo, any ad that I see on any page that I get from Google is by definition today irrelevant. Look at what they're telling me. Do you think they're showing this to the advertisers who are paying them for every click I do? I doubt it. So that's the problem. There is no more traditional segmentation. So here's my thesis. We are in a new place. It's called Generation World. And Generation World has no age. It has no borders. And believe it or not, it has way more in common than not. So let's talk about age first. Here's the truth, right? We are all doing all the same things, young people and old people, right? Go out any day and look at the people who are surfboarding. Look at the people who are skateboarding. Look at the people who are doing the things that we've traditionally associated with younger audiences, and you'll find a lot of gray hair. I would have said bald heads. However, many young people shave their heads today, so that doesn't quite work. But you'll find a lot of gray hair out there because more and more we find a confluence of interest, a confluence of activity. People want to keep doing what they were doing. And because we're healthier, because we're able to, we continue to do it. Let's look at borders. I love this example. So I once called Starbucks in Paris the American revenge on the French. This is probably the double American revenge on the French. Imagine selling hot dogs from a stand on a corner in Paris. And yet, young Paris hipsters are saying, this is the greatest thing we've ever seen. We love this, right? They call it Très Brooklyn, you know? This is very, very cool because they associate that with something very, very cool. Totally borderless. We've now taken what's happening in New York, or any place in the world, but let's just take New York, a particularly powerful New York activity, which is eating on street corners, and we've brought it to Paris with the same food. Whoever would have thought that we could have done that? And then we have more and more in common. Let me tell you about this one, Angry Birds. How many people play Angry Birds? Yes, me too. It's terrible, right? I once played it on a plane with Sir Martin Sorrell, who's my boss. I thought he was asleep, and he looked over and he said to me, "That's what I pay you for?" The joke was that 3 weeks later, he had the chairman of Angry Birds at the WPP board meeting because he saw really, in fact, that it was a powerful meeting. But could we just play the little video clip? All right, get the point? This is not my grandchild, but I can tell you that in fact, we get the slides back, that in fact, my three-year-old grandson plays exactly like that. So I play it, he plays it, that little kid plays it, in some places my presentation. Yes? I don't have it down here, sorry. Okay, thank you. So what's happened is we have this ability now to go like this, right? Everybody get this? Right? This is anybody of any age turning on an iPad. Now, why is that important? Because no other time in the history of the world, no other time have we been able to have a three-year-old and an 80-year-old use the same tool in the same way. Think about that. Think about how powerful that is. Think about what it was like back when three-year-olds couldn't pull a bow and arrow, right? Three-year-olds couldn't take a shovel and dig a ditch. But three-year-olds can, in fact, pick up an iPad, turn it on, and use it. Powerful. It's unbelievable. Generation World. So here's what's happened, right? Generation World has created a bigger world, right? So we're much bigger. It's like we look out. We could be in Brooklyn. We can be in Bangkok. We can be in Bangladesh. We can be in Berlin, and nobody knows. And we've also created a much smaller world because of mobile, the world is as small as the palm of my hand, and it's right around the corner because I can find my way there. It's also created a more connected world. We're connected with those same people over the world, but it's also more siloed, right? So we have this dichotomy here. Because in fact, the internet has created incredible silos. And some of those silos, if you see what's happening right now in Egypt and in Iran, that is a silo. That's a silo of activity that's happening because of a particular group that's watching a particular set of things and make it happen. So you would think that in a more connected, more global world, that wouldn't happen, and yet it does because of the same power that we're talking to. So here's the question, are we defined by technology or are we empowered by it? Which is it? How do we define ourselves? How do we empower ourselves? So I think this is an important quote, right? We all know about the Arab Spring. We all know about the one percenters that have been all over the world. The canard is, right? The analysts love to write that it was the revolution of Facebook. It was the digital revolution. Wrong. Read what the people themselves on the streets said. So this is from Time magazine. Technology mattered, but this was not a technological revolution. It was not a wired revolution. It was a human one of hearts and minds, the oldest technology of all. It was a revolution about values. Yes, in fact, Facebook and digital made it easier, made it quicker, made it more efficient. But in the end, many of you know that in Egypt in the beginning, they took the internet down. You couldn't get Facebook. You couldn't tweet. You couldn't SMS. And yet all the people came together. It was the power of the people. And if you don't believe that, go back and look at the Russian Revolution. I'm sure you all know this story. Read about the Potemkin. Like, help me figure out where the hell all those people came from in the course of 2 hours without Facebook, without cell phones, without anything. Because the hearts and minds, that is the oldest revolution of all. So when we look at all the faces, we look at all the people around, it's amazing how you could take the pictures any place and it was the same people, the same faces. And by the way, they were of all ages. And here's why. Because we have two things happening, right? We have age compression on one side, because children are maturing earlier. We have that three-year-old who can go like this and use an iPad. But we have age expansion on the other side, where Wester Wunderman, the chairman of our Wunderman company, one of my sister companies, who's 93 years old, comes into the office every day and works with Google and Facebook and all of the latest and most important modern technologies, because he understands them and uses them. So we have age compression on one side, age expansion on the other side. We also have an increase in multi-generational homes. Now, I think what's really funny, this isn't new. This goes back 150 years. This is how people used to live. But we went through a period of time where it didn't exist. Now, because of the economic situation, we're back again to multi-generational homes. So in fact, we have grandchildren, parents, great-grandparents, all living together in the same home. And think about what that does. Think about how that affects the world and think about what happens. So let's look at some brands. So we went back to the 1990s and we said, what were the leadership brands? What were the most important brands? And I said, you know what? Let's look at it against 18 to 29 and 50 plus. Let's pretend that we're living today and that we're living in this world of segmentation. We think it's really the younger people who are driving the digital, right? So it's really interesting. If you looked in 1990, and this is all from our BAV, Brand Asset Valuator. It's a proprietary YNR tool. You're all welcome to go to YNR.com and look it up. It's a very interesting tool. I don't want to spend the time now describing it. But let me just tell you that if I look at it and I said, all right, 18 to 29-year-olds, what brands were important to them and what attributes of those brands were important to them in 1990, right? So Maybelline, Ericsson, Tower Records, could have been Virgin Records. But what they were interested in were brands that were energetic and emotional. If I looked at the 50 pluses in 1990, right, Weight Watchers, Old Spice, Saks Fifth Avenue, really just sort of basic old-fashioned brands, very functional. That's what they were interested in, very functional brands. Now let's jump ahead to today, 20 years later, right? If I look at leadership brands among 18 to 50 plus, they are the same. They have converged. So Nike, eBay, We, TripAdvisor, Ray-Ban, Mercedes, Coke, IKEA, these are the brands that mean the same things. So whether you're 18 or 50 plus, these are the important brands to you, and the attributes that you give to them, original, authentic, fun, friendly, dynamic, are the same. So when you look across the world and you say, what's grown, take a look at the percentage growth in converged brands. In other words, this is the percentage of brands across the world where we see leadership converging between 18 to 50 plus. Look at the growth, it's unbelievable. So again, generation world, people are coming together in ways they didn't have. So let's go to some proof, and I'll just take you through quickly some points in BAV. So if we look at Facebook back in 2007, and you look down at the lower quadrant in the green, and you say, okay, take a look, who are the top people, the top right-hand quadrant, who are the top Facebook users? They were females, 18 to 24. Go to the second one, 2011, look at it today. They've all converged. They've all converged, generation world. It's hard to tell them apart because we all use it. Let's take a look in the UK at HBO. Take a look at the arrow moving from left to right. If we go back to 1997, adults 50 plus didn't think that much of HBO. HBO was much more for adults 18 to 29. Look at it today. They've converged. Generation world, they feel the same. When we look at food, right, this is one of the biggest noodle companies in China. Now, why is it important? Because, first of all, Western food has started to become incredibly popular in China. It's also very hard to break out if you're a noodle company. So this is a noodle company that went back to authenticity. Get it? Authenticity, something that we say, oh, it's only the young people want things that are authentic. Hell. We all want things that are authentic. That's what I'm trying to say. That's what we're proving here. So when we go back, we say, look at this. Young people, old people, they all buy authenticity. That's what they're all interested in. And gaming is the best, right? So I'm not the only old guy who is a gamer, thank God. We look at this, we see, in fact, there's been a convergence in gaming. And by the way, that convergence is also male and female. So most people would think that gaming was for men 18 to 34, wrong. Many women game as well, and many young kids game as well. So again, generation world, we've converged, even around something like gaming. So now let's take a look at some brands, right? These are the important brands that I think you need to pay attention to and that I learned from, because these are the brands that, to me, prove the point. One is Uniqlo. How many people have been to a Uniqlo? Not enough. You should all go, because Uniqlo is an amazing experience. The thing about Uniqlo is you walk in there, try to figure out the demographic. Try to figure out the age. Try to figure out the socioeconomic basis of anybody who's in there. You can't, because that is who they are, their generation world. And go to their website, because it's very instructive. Read about the people that they profile. Look at the ages. Look at the different people. Look at what they do. Generation world. American Apparel. Very, very popular and growing company in the U.S. She is one of their top models, believe it or not. She is one of their top models. Why? Because this company that was originally founded thinking that 18 to 34 would be their big audience, and probably 18 to 22 being the biggest part, suddenly discovered that a huge part of their audience was over 50, men and women. Generation world, it's all coming together. And lest you think this is Germany, it's not. This is New York. So it's not just the French who are eating American food, but we in New York are also taking food from all over the world and trying to create an environment, an experience, as if we were there. It's never as good. Trust me, I know that for a fact, but it's okay. We do our best. So what are the learnings? I think the learnings are important. Again, you have to get back to the shared values. First is, we live life in constant beta. This is critical, right? So Microsoft and Apple and everyone else has taught us about beta. Can you imagine 20 years ago, you lived in a world where you bought something and the guy said, yeah, take this now. Don't worry about it. It's not finished. But in 6 months, I'll give you the next piece of it. Right? Like, would you have bought anything like that? Yet we do this all the time. Right? We buy 1.0 knowing that 1.2, 1.3, and 2.7 are all coming. Right? So we live life in constant beta. We're ready to try. We're ready to test because we understand that that's how it goes. Second, access is the new ownership. This is critical. When I grew up, I wanted records. Remember those things? For those of you who are too young to know that, records were these vinyl things that went on, these turned around, you heard music. It was magic. It was unbelievable. And then we went to cassettes, and we had 8 tracks, God forbid. People should remember that one. And now we have digital music. And interestingly enough, people are going back to records. I just got for my birthday 2 weeks ago from my 18-year-old nephew who bought me a turntable that allows me to play my records and turns it into digital files. So talk about a confluence of things. But access and ownership. I don't need to own anymore, right? I don't need those DVDs. I don't have to own a DVD. I don't need a record. I don't need a car. Most things I don't need. I don't need movies. I don't need VHS. I don't need DVD. I don't need CDs. Access is a new ownership. I can access all of that when I want, pay for it when I want, use it when I want. Access and ownership, huge implications here for all of us. Huge implications for marketers. What does that mean? Right? So if you're a high-end retail, I'm not sure it means that you can just access the jacket you want at that particular time. But access is really important, right? This one is wild. So looking at Pinterest, right? 70% of users share recipes or cooking-related photos. Now, this is not new. Talk to anybody. Talk to any sociologist. They'll tell you, what do people share pre-digital? They shared recipes. They shared food. These are the kinds of things they shared. We're going back to sharing. It's not like people are going online and sharing incredible digital experiences. They're sharing the food they're eating. They're sharing the food from the restaurants they go in. What don't we get here, people? So we talk about digital experiences as if there's something happening out there, right? Something in the ether, something in the cloud that we experience that's different than what we experience on Earth. We use those things to share our experiences, but the experiences are happening in the world. Generation world, they're real experiences, they're important to us. And then think about how global has become local. Now, we've always talked about this, we've always talked about global, but I love this, right? So this is from McDonald's. So take a look. McDonald's only 20 years ago was nuts about their burgers. Had to be the same beef, and it had to be where they bought the potatoes, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Just take a look at some of the products that they're selling around the world, whether it's the mashed potato burger in China or the falafel burger, my favorite, in Saudi Arabia. But this one just came across last week because they're opening the first vegetarian outlets in India. It's brilliant. Now, of course, in India, people are saying, what the hell took these people so long? Like, how come they couldn't figure this out before? But okay, give them credit. They're doing it now. So look at that. So branding people, all the big branding companies out there, it's, oh my God, they're killing the brand because they're not selling hamburgers. The business people are going, wow, boy, keep coming up with those ideas, right? This is what we need to do. Generation world. So here's the bottom line, and I actually finished on time. Rethink the boundaries of your audience. Because if you think that we live in a digital world that is somehow virtually digital, and that it's exclusively the domain of some very well and predefined audience, you will miss the biggest opportunities that any of us have. Because we live in a real world, and the digital world that we have around us enhances, expands, and brings us to what I call digital exponential, which is the ability to use tools to create a better world and a better life for ourselves. But it's not one that we live in exclusively. So I thank you. That's my blog, weeklyramble.com. You're all invited to listen. I don't know if we have time for any questions. Yes, no? I think there's 1 minute and 20 seconds left, so. If we have, I decided I was going to be the one speaker to finish exactly on time. But if we have one question or two questions, I'm sure that we can take one. Anybody?
Somebody with a question? I'll be there with the microphone if you have a question.
I don't get lunch if I don't get at least one question.
It's just 1 minute left, David, now.
Actually, 58 seconds.
55 seconds.
So if not, I will be around. I'd be happy to answer any questions. And I thank you all for listening, and have a great rest of the conference.
David Sables, ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much. It was great. Thank you so much.